And greetings and salutations, everyone. You have tuned into Networking for Success here at UBN Go, here in the heart of beautiful downtown Burbank. I'm your host, Walt Lusk, and as always, we have John Dade and a very, very special guest in studio. We have Sandro. I'm going to butcher it, buddy. I don't want to give it
Sandro Schoehoefer.
There it is. Thank you guys for having me.
And John is the author of the book, Is Your Networking Net Working? You can get it where books are sold, Barnes & Noble, Amazon, or call the show.
Absolutely.
Call-in is a call-in show, and you'd be happy to be part of it. The number is area code 323. There's a number. Oh, there it is. 323-524-2599. That's 323-524-2599. And this is our third installment of John's book. And our first one was called The Aha Moment.
The Aha Moment, yep. Yes.
And the last one was, no, the first one was I'm Stuck.
Second one was The
Aha Moment. Was last week, the last episode. And this episode is entitled,
They will come.
If they build it, they will come.
Absolutely.
And we're going to have a lot of fun with some pioneers in industry, in addition to Sandro and others.
And others. There we go.
Right. Well, it's a pleasure to be here, Walt. Hello, everyone.
Hey, John. Good to see you again.
As Walt mentioned, I'm the author of the book, Is Your Networking Networking? A little bit about me. I'm a multi-licensed financial professional, wealth management, utilizing both alternative strategies, investment strategies, and as well as the usual stocks, bonds, equities, these type of thing. We also offer business succession planning, help you set up your 401k, basically a full suite of financial solutions. Also the founder of a group called the Cigar Night Business Mixer Group, which is a gathering of business owners, executives, professionals that get together on a monthly basis with chapters in LA, San Diego, and Orange County to network at a whole different level, enjoying their passion for a fine cigar and a premium spirit. And again, I'd like to welcome my guest, Sandro Schoehoefer. Welcome, man. It's
a
pleasure working with you.
This is definitely a privilege to be here, so thank you.
Great to be here. We just saw each other yesterday. He was great. He was at a golf tournament yesterday at the Monarch Beach Resort in South Orange County, and doing some tastings of his absolutely wonderful product, Lost Republic Bourbon and Rye, which we'll get into later.
Yeah, Lost Republic is a phenomenal distillery. I'm going to steal your thunder a little bit. They are based in Napa Valley, which actually is an amazing place to grow distill.
And specifically Healdsburg.
And in Healdsburg in the Napa Valley area.
That's a specific area.
And they actually distill their own product.
Yes, sir.
Absolutely. And I'm a bourbon guy, and it is phenomenal. You got to check it out. Lost Republic. We'll get into that.
Yeah, we're actually going to check it out while we're here.
there you go.
You guys at home, you have to check with your local distributor, your local liquor vendor, so you can get some and check it out with us on the next show.
We're just going to do a little quality control, make sure it's good on air.
Well, QC is important. QC is very important.
Absolutely. I don't bring anything on board that I don't enjoy. So this is a little quality control.
Yes, and they have rye as well. And I really hadn't been exposed much to rye. And it's different, but their rye is, as Sandra will elaborate, good stuff as well. Really is. It's quality stuff.
Yeah, it is. I mean, I'm not a bourbon guy myself. Or certainly not a rye person. I'm more of a scotch, tequila, rum, any other type of alcohol. When I was introduced to that, you know, when we met, I tried the rye, and oh, my God.
Yeah.
I would drink that rye.
Yeah. It's smooth.
And I remember that conversation. We were at Hannah's in Rancho de Margarita.
Yeah, absolutely.
And we sat down, and you started the conversation saying, Sandro, look, I'll be honest with you. I'm not a bourbon guy. I'm not a rye guy. So let's see what happens. You tasted that rye, and you said, "Wow, I could drink this." That's a compliment and a half.
And that started a relationship that it's still going on today.
Most definitely.
Now, elaborate a little bit on your cigar business nights that we're going to talk about. If it build it, they will come.
Absolutely.
And that's actually the there's a line in the front of the chapter from Harvey McKay, entitled says, "Quote: If you do not belong to a private club, create your own." And I have to interject and respond to that from a Groucho Marx comment. And the Groucho Marx comment is, I will not join any club that would have me as a member.
Well, that's why I'm not a member. See, I'm a founder. There's a difference.
And I'm a vendor.
So I always love that. Groucho Marx, got to love it. I would not join any club that would want and have me as a member.
Correct. Correct. I mean, it's just, it started, again, out of necessity. I needed to meet a certain type of client in the business I was in. They enjoyed the finer things in life, and that included good scotch, good cigars, and what have you. We started 9 years ago, and it was a way to become, you know, my own center of influence. And four or five of us got together and decided what we need to do to build an organization that would draw people to us instead of us going out and trying to find all these people to share our products with. So we basically sat down and said, okay, we'll build it and hope they will come. And 9 years later, you know, thank God, they're still coming.
Yes, they are. And you are not only in Southern California in three counties.
Yes.
Los Angeles, Orange County, and San Diego. But you're looking at, are you still seriously considering Houston? Is that the next?
Well, we're looking at, we've been approached by Phoenix,
Phoenix
and Houston.
Yeah, Phoenix, Houston.
As well. So, you know, it's one of those things where you talk about getting it set up, you build a team, mm-hmm. put the team together, and help them launch it. It's a cookie cutter formula. You just have to be dedicated and build it around, you know, your passion.
Absolutely. And guns, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Spirits.
No, you don't have to be sorry. You're the host.
Guns. I know you're talking about guns. Spirits and cigars is the primary part, and they're serious about cigars. They even had a class 3 months ago in Orange County on Cigar 101, how to light it and how they made. And that was really fascinating. I showed up for that one.
Yeah, well, I learned a lot from that one, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, we really appreciate cool. you being there. And, yeah. and Sandro was also doing a tasting table there.
Yes, that was the first time you did a tasting table.
Yeah. It was the most popular table. We had to drag him from them over to our Cigar 101.
He was, actually.
I'm doing Bourbon 101. I don't need no damn Cigar 101.
John, I wish I felt bad about that.
Yeah, I could tell you were really upset.
And then the next one, it was in Orange County. There was another competitor of yours, and he sauntered over finally at my encouragement to check yours out, and he was very duly impressed.
Well, yeah.
That's good stuff.
It makes a great pot. Matter of fact, quit talking, start pouring.
Let's do it.
All right.
So while you guys are pouring, I thought I would elaborate a little bit on, and we can have a discussion on,
sure.
If you build it, will they come?
Yes.
And
we hope.
The thing is, really, it's a relationship between intent and outcome. It's because just because you have the intent of doing something or building something, are people going to take advantage of it, participate, and, of course, come? So if you put thought and energy into whatever you're doing, you will actually increase the likelihood of success. Because if you stay home and sit on your butt, chances are it isn't going to be successful except sitting on your ass. So
everybody's got something, Walt. Come on.
Yeah, I know. And sitting there watching the reruns of Bonanza.
Homer Simpson made a career out of it.
Yes, he did. I like to watch the reruns of Bonanza and eat bonbons. But attention plants a seed, while effort, time, and action gives the seed the best opportunity to grow and thrive. So if you pay no attention to an idea and make no effort, then obviously nothing's going to happen, right? Is that Homer Simpson's mantra? So the iconic line, if you build it, he will come, is actually the original line. But
that's the original line.
I like
yes.
they better, because more the merrier, right?
I tweaked it because I needed more than one he.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, and that's not politically correct, by the way.
So. That's all right.
That's why I had to go they.
That's okay. It's more fun with they. I mean, one's the loneliest number, right? So.
Yeah.
Still, manifesting the reality through thought and willpower, and the old concept can be seen throughout history as mind over matter, and it actually works. And John is a proof of it, and Lost Republic is also proof of it.
That's correct. I'm going to have you jump in, and you know the theme is build that they will come, and I immediately thought of you for this chapter, third chapter of the book, because that, to me, is what you and Matt have done. And we'll talk to Matt later. He's going to phone in, Matt Reese. So tell us why you built it, how you built it, and how are they coming?
And take all the time you need, Sandro.
No, thank you guys. So kind of a backstory of how I got started, basically, is I played soccer at Sonoma State. And picked up injuries along the way. And
I hate it when that happens.
Yeah, not the best thing, but I made a decision my senior year, 2 weeks prior to my senior season, when I blew out my knee. I was like, you know what, I can either sit at home like we were talking about and think of what to do, or I can just go do. And I asked Mr. Weiss for a job, and I started at the bottom. Started bottling, then worked my way up to running the bottlings, then becoming his assistant, then becoming the local rep. And when Southern California opened up, I raised my hand very quickly because there's some really nice beaches down here. And Northern California lies to you. They didn't they tell you that there's beaches up there. It's a coastline.
But it gets cold.
It gets cold. Yeah.
And foggy.
So I kind of took and looked at what Matt Weiss was doing in Northern California and really said, hey, how can I replicate this in Southern California? And one of the things was work ethic. It was less sitting at home thinking about, oh, do we do this? Do we do that? Do we do this? Hey, let's just go sell. Let's put this in front of people. Let's talk to them. Let's tell them why we're doing what we're doing, what's different about it. And hey, if they like it, great. And if not, it's okay. And we kind of kept that mindset. And everything that I'm doing today, every success that I have is definitely attributed to the Weiss family and Lost Republic because they definitely brought me under their wing.
Well, it's certainly working, and you followed the path of many great people who threw down that gauntlet and said, okay, you know, I'm going to build it, and they will come. Mm-hmm. You know, Henry Ford being one of them.
Ford.
And we're going to, Walt's going to expand on some others. But
absolutely.
I'll throw the names out, and then we'll discuss them. Yeah,
sure.
Walt Disney, for sure, especially here in Orange County.
Definitely.
Walter Knott.
Yep.
Lee Iacocca. I mean, he did for the auto industry probably second to what Ford did.
And he actually worked for Ford, as we all know, and he had lightning struck him twice.
Yes, absolutely.
The Mustang and the minivan.
The damn minivan.
A flipping minivan.
So we'll expand on those as well, but the same work ethic, the hard work, and I will tell you from watching Sandro and being with him all these months, he is one of the hardest working people in the industry, but he does it with passion, and
yes,
it comes
he does.
Through.
Yes,
there's
he does.
A passion.
Absolutely.
For him, it's not work. You can tell. He's having a hell of a time, and he loves his product, and he loves what he does.
Most definitely.
What do you think sets Lost Republic, and I know that's a very tasty question, over others, over your other bourbons specifically,
and rye? That's a great question. So what we're trying to do is the wine-making approach to whiskey.
Oh, wow. There you go.
And basically what that means is in wine, you want to showcase fruit and kind of elevate that fruit and make it the showcase of the product. And we want to do the same thing with the grain and whiskey because we think it's underrepresented. So when you drink in Lost Republic, you're going to experience something that's lighter, one in color, one in like kind of heaviness on the palate, and something that you can drink all day. And I always tell people that Lost Republic's a whiskey that you can drink for the long run, but we're not going to punish you on the way. And I think that really speaks to what we're doing.
I like that. And it goes well with a good cigar. Last time I had this over the weekend, I did with an Alec Bradley Black Market with the bourbon. And I tell you, that was a great evening.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
There you go. And it didn't overpower the cigar, and that worked out great.
It complemented it every step of the way.
Yeah. Cool. What's been the most prevalent response when people taste it?
Well, it's awesome because I think the response is kind of the similar response that John had when rye whiskey is intimidating to people because of all the harshness and the pepper notes and whatnot. And ours is subtle. I always make the joke that sometimes a rye will punch you in the face. Well, this one's going to slap you. You're still going to get hit, but it's going to be a little more gentle. And I always say it's an approachable rye, something that's there for everybody.
I like that word. It very, very approachable.
Very approachable.
Yes.
It is. Yeah. And I hadn't really drunk a lot of rye at all. I had nothing to compare it to, but it's good stuff.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah, really, it's good stuff.
And following up, on the bill that they will come, if you don't belong to a private club, create one. That's kind of what I did with the cigar group. I didn't belong to any private clubs, so I decided to create my own.
Well, you mentioned that you had some exposure to Business Network International. You want to touch on that, 6 degrees, Provisor, and then your own, of course. So did you actually go to other groups and see what they were doing and how you really didn't want, per all Groucho Marx, to be a member?
Yes, I went to other networking groups. Obviously, networking is what you have to do in any sales industry. Mm-hmm. And certainly Sandro is a great example of that. He's out there hustling and networking consistently. But you see the good and the bad, and every group has its members and it works for them. I didn't find that any in that particular genre worked for me. So me and my partner set out to create our own that met the needs that we had. Again, going back to build it, and they will. We hope they will come, and again, they have.
Well, and a lot of those groups are breakfast meetings, and you got to get up at you get crack of dawn and eat their sad eggs and crappy bacon and
absolutely,
and you know, and everybody's babbling about the same old stuff. It's kind of hard to smoke a cigar and have some bourbon at 6 o'clock in the morning.
That's true.
It can
that's
be done.
True. That's true. And I mean,
yes, it can be done. There's a restaurant in Orange County called Kino's, and they start at 6 o'clock in the morning with their eye opener Bloody Mary.
Guess where I'm going to be on Sunday.
I remember that.
Yeah. Yes, I've been there for having breakfast, and I was early on in the sales business, and I'll be darn, there's guys ponied up to the bar at 7 a.m. powering down their eye opener Bloody Mary, and I'm thinking, oh my goodness gracious.
True, yes, true. Thank God things have been good, and I'm a member of a private club now called the Center Club, and I'm not a morning person. I only go to 2 breakfast meetings a month that start at 7 or 7:30, and I tell them right up front, I don't function until 9, so don't expect a lot. But at one of them, at the end of the meeting, they give you a ticket to go to the bar and get a Bloody Mary to start your Friday morning.
Oh, my goodness gracious.
That works for me.
If I had that, I'd go home and take a nap. Getting back to Lost Republic, so the responses have been obviously very positive, and it's growing. And I know you're making a killing here in Southern California in terms of introducing it to folks.
No, it's starting to catch a little bit of fire, and I've noticed that especially when entering the LA market, it's beautiful to see. It's almost incredible when you call somebody and say, "Hey, my name's Sandro. I work for a distillery in Sonoma County," and they go, "Wait, is it Lost Republic?" And I go, "Well, yes, it is." I'm like, "Oh, well, I'd love to taste with you." And to think back 7-8 months ago.
There you go.
And I was in October, and I was grinding and working and doing my thing. To think that 8 months in the future, somebody's going to hear about that. And that's what makes it so worthwhile, is that I can see a direct impact of what I'm making.
Well, I'm sorry to say your reputation precedes you.
And that's a good thing.
Yeah,
that is a good thing.
And his reputation tastes pretty damn good.
Most definitely, true.
My friend. You don't get any, Walt. You're in charge.
No, I got to work.
No, but it's one of those things, and I always
and
have taken the
we
stance.
Have a caller.
Do we have a call in?
I wonder who that could be.
Oh, there we go. Good evening, and you're on the air with Sandro and John.
Well, good evening, guys. This is Matt Weiss.
Hey,
from
Matt. Welcome.
Lost Republic Distilling Company.
Hey, Matt.
Welcome.
Thank you for having me.
No problem. The topic discussion, I don't know if Sandro shared it with you, is basically build it and they will come. That's the third chapter of my book. And that's the reason I had Sandro on with us today, is because he and Lost Republic and you and your efforts kind of epitomize that to me. So we wanted to have you call in and tell us a little bit about what was your aha moment and why you built it, and hope they will come.
I think the aha moment. So Lost Republic is a collaboration between Colin Harder, my best friend, and I, and we've come up with some crazy ideas over the years. But this is the idea that Colin's wife said yes to. So that was the aha moment.
Is that her aha moment? Or yours or hers?
I hope she's listening, because you just made some points.
Well, at least you guys didn't name it after her.
But we have taken a little bit of a different approach than our constituents in the industry, in that we self-distribute. So for distilleries, the most common route to market is through a distributor. And we opted to skip the distributor for the one main reason of, we really wanted to tell our story and not play the telephone game. We wanted us telling our story directly to our customers and building relationships with those customers. Our customers are the trades, the bars and the restaurants and the retailers. And that's what's most important to us, is are those relationships. And well, so I don't think that there's anything, you know, better than a handshake and you know, a face-to-face meeting. And everybody that has our product has tasted it and approved it and liked it. Sandro can attest that we avoid the hard sell. Mm-hmm. If it's not something that they think they can be successful with, we're okay with them passing on it. We want to be the places where we can build relationships, and that's the foundation that we're basing Lost Republic on.
Well, I think it's my personal opinion. I spent 18 years in the restaurant industry, and I think this is going to be a winner. When I was first exposed to it with Sandro, and you've got a gold mine in his ability and his eagerness and his love for his passion for what he does. I tasted it. One of the first things I shared with him, and we discussed this earlier on the show, that is, I'm more of a Scotch, tequila, rum, bourbon guy. I told him right up front when we met, I'm not a bourbon guy and I'm certainly not a rye guy. And he said, okay. And he poured it anyway. And I tell you what, I was converted. And I don't do that lightly. So he's definitely, you've definitely done something right, and he's definitely a great point man for you here, you know, especially in Southern California.
Well, you know, on the topic of if you build it and they will come, another thing that we do, I don't know if it's unique, but more so old school, is we've identified, as far as hiring and employees, is that the most important thing is to hire good people. And we have an extensive training program. And so Sandro came to us and started working as a bottler, and then became a sales assistant, and now is managing Southern California for us. And through that time, he's learned, you know, how we like to do business. We go in depth with, you know, not only what to say, but how to say it, and how to approach situations. And Sandro and I are in constant communication. And the best part of that is I know Sandro's a good person, and I trust him to be out there, and we're in constant communication. And so, you know, I think that building your employees is another, you know, probably another radio subject, but along the same line.
Absolutely.
Yes, it is. I don't know if you're watching. I don't know if you're watching live on your computer or not, but. You know, we did take the courtesy or liberty, whichever word you want, to bring a couple bottles and showcase them on the show and what have you, because they're that good.
Oh, thank you. No, I'm not watching live. I'm just here jealous that I'm out there drinking with you.
That's okay. We'll make sure that Sandro sends you a copy of the YouTube link.
Yeah, and John, don't tell him you're holding a cigar as well, because then twice the jealousy is going to come out.
Oh, you mean this beautiful Alec Bradley lost? Yeah, it's. I'm thinking of you, Matt.
Yeah, you guys are really working hard over there. Really yeah. Working hard for Sandro. Good. Yeah. Good.
Little Alec Bradley, little black market going on here. We're actually, because we're not, you know, per se, on the radio officially. You know, we can actually get away with doing this and having a good time. Sandro, jump in.
No, most definitely. So along the lines of Matt, of kind of what we're doing in Southern California, we were talking about like how I differ, or we differ in the way we do business. And that's kind of, I know Matt can attest to me texting in orders at like 12, 1 o'clock in the morning.
Wow.
And him the next morning going, what the hell were you doing? And you're like, well, if they don't answer my phone, I show up when the bar's closing down and try to catch the bar manager and whatnot and kind of hold a face to face. And
that's a unique, that's a great approach. And the bar, a lot of people miss that because quite frankly, the bartenders are the ones, they're the first interaction with the public.
Yeah.
And I know myself when I go into a new bar, mm-hmm. or even the regulars that know me now, I'll ask them, you know what I usually drink, this mm-hmm. and that. You know, what do you recommend that you've heard about there that's new that you think I would like that would meet that profile? And they are the first contact, and inevitably
yep.
they do well.
Unfortunately, we're going to have to kill it because we had cameras.
Yeah, we have a saying, it's one thing to get on the shelf. It's another thing to get pulled back off the shelf.
Yeah.
Yes.
And our front lines are our brand ambassadors. And you know, those are the people that are out there that really have gravitated towards our flavor profile and our branding and are passing that word along to, you, John. So
appreciate it.
It's a, bigly important part of our business is developing those relationships on all levels, not just with the buyer, but also with the people that are in the aisles, the people that are behind the bar, and the people that the waiters, all the way to the hostess.
Excellent. Well, I wish you much success at that. We're gonna cut away to another section here, and what have you. I do appreciate you calling it in, and Sandro and I'll take it from here, and hopefully we can have you call in and back on again, and Sandro will get you a copy of the show.
You guys have a great time. Thanks so much.
Hey, thanks,
my
Matt.
Pleasure. Thanks for taking time, Matt.
Appreciate it.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Well, that was absolutely a great conversation, and I can tell that he respects you a lot, and he's a real good guy. And I think Lobster Republic is just getting started. I mean, as I said earlier, your reputation precedes you, Sandro.
Absolutely. There's a lot of energy in that call. I can see why you enjoy working with him.
Most definitely.
Everything. It's
and as you guys know, it's a great economy, and I could work for anybody on the face of the planet, but it is a privilege to work for Lost Republic.
I like it.
Yeah. And the fact that you started at the bottom and worked your way up, I mean, that's there's a guy named Mike Geffen who started in the mailroom.
Yeah.
And at a agency, and obviously is not in the mailroom anymore. In fact, when he started working, funny story, they said, oh, you want to be an agent? Okay, well, where'd you go to school? Oh, I went to UCLA. Great. When you get your transcripts, let me know, and we'll figure it out. So he had to get to the mailroom, as he did every day, and look for the letter from UCLA regarding his lack of a transcript, and was able to head it off and create a transcript. And subsequently, he donated a bunch of money to UCLA for a building.
Great story.
So that somebody else great could story. Generate their own transcript.
Time to cut and paste.
Pretty much. So moving on, we mentioned Henry Ford. And Henry Ford was actually one of the, doing a little research on him, was one of the most amazing innovators, I think, in the last century. Because when he started his Model T, there were two things that didn't exist. One was roads,
yep.
And two were people that were driving cars.
Yep.
So there was only, I don't know if you know this, John, but there was less than 100 miles of paved roads in the United States when he introduced the car in 1908.
Wow. I did not know that.
Yeah.
That was before my time, Walt.
I mean, the horse and buggy was really it. And he created a market that actually, getting a little ahead of myself, but by 1927, when the Model A was introduced, over 56% of America had at least one car, and chances are it was a Ford.
Wow. And he was very generous because he told them they could have that any color they wanted, as long as it was black.
exactly. So, and as a result, of course, all the cars, then the numbered highway system was developed and built for years and years and years and years to come. So, I mean, you talk about an innovator. No one had ever really owned a car before. It was a first-time buyer. How do you convince somebody to take their horse and buggy, put it somewhere in the out to pasture, and buy this car?
I know. I mean, it was a great sales job.
It was unbelievable. And not only that, he had to crank them out really quick. And so he actually developed and perfected the assembly line.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Yes. And to add to that, most people think that he invented the car because that's how ingrained
Mercedes
his is.
Did.
He didn't invent it. He created a car, but he perfected the assembly line.
Absolutely. Yeah. And when it was all said and done, he tweaked it and whatnot and had a chain pulling the car, and people were doing repetitive stuff to build the car. And when they started, it was 12 and a half hours to build a car. And when he finished, it took an hour and a half.
Wow.
And as a result of all the assemblies he was creating here in the United States, and he did this in England as well, it was a car rolling off the line every 24 seconds.
Wow.
Sold 15 million Model Ts.
That's insane.
And then in 1927, he repeated himself and started the Model A and created another 15 million of those as well. And what's really interesting is that the Model T was the most popular car ever until 1972, when the Beetle, developed by Adolf Hitler and Ferdinand Porsche, surpassed it. And the Beatles just finally, I think this is their last year for the Beatles. Interesting.
Yeah, they're ending production.
Yeah, they're ending production. Yeah.
My sister's not happy about
that. Yeah. They were producing them in Mexico, actually, for a while, and then he's in production there. You could actually get a Beatle in Mexico that looked like a original 1960s, 59s Beatle in Mexico.
That.
And that just recently stopped.
Huh.
Yeah. And the Model T was called the 10 Lizzie.
And
they even had, that was just what they called it, was just a 10 Lizzie. That was just the nickname of it.
Wow.
And the Model A is called the Baby Lincoln. And they even had ragtops and everything else. I mean, convertibles and the whole nine yards for people to drive them. Mm-hmm. I thought that was really cool. So when he introduced and unveiled the Model A, literally in a few cities, 25 million Americans, that's one out of five, out of every man, woman, and child in the country at that time, wanted to go see it, and literally stormed all of the dealerships unbelievably, probably never since, the first week that it was introduced, because it was a new car, and okay, we're done with the Model T, what's the Model A, and, and away they went. So it was just incredible. And it was a four-cylinder, the Model A. It had a 200 cubic inch engine, had a 40 horsepower. It was a comfortable cruising speed at 40 to 45 miles an hour, but it could go to 65.
That was pretty quick back then.
Yeah,
that's pretty fast.
And it also allowed the use of lower grade fuels, because remember, gas had to be invented, and so they didn't have premium and regular and whatnot. So and longevity, dependability, and simplicity was the thing of the day of the Ford. And he obviously was unbelievably successful at it.
He built it, and they obviously
created a major market, created a highway system as a result of his creation.
About market presence, huh?
It's unbelievable. Yeah, at the end of World War II, the Model A became the unchallenged queen of the vintage car scene. And for a brief moment in history, 1920 to 31, it generated the largest gathering of enthusiasm around a single model that no other car has had ever since. And you can actually, right now, if you wanted to, since it was so simple, for about $50,000, you could get all the parts and recreate the Model A.
Wow.
I don't know why anybody would, except maybe Jay Leno.
Looks like our computer screen went dim over there, so I don't know what we got there.
We're still good here.
All righty.
All right. Technology.
Is my foot. Improvise, adapt, overcome.
So Henry Ford was an incredible titan, and I know he had a really good relationship with his friend, Mr. Firestone.
And let me see.
So you can bet that Firestone tires were on all the Fords until the 90s when they went. When they had issues on the, and if you remember the Blazer, and they had tire issues, but that worked for ever a long time.
Well, that's a great relationship. I mean,
yes,
that's created a brand on top of his brand.
Yeah. Yes, And then since you're in finance, John, I know you know this. When General Motors started selling cars, they came up with GMAC.
Yes.
General Motors Acceptance Corporation.
Yes.
Which financed all of the cars they sold.
Which is another.
And they made more money per vehicle on the financing than they did on the wholesaling and the selling of the vehicle itself.
Wow. Oh, I believe that. I believe that. Yes.
Yeah. And they had issues, and when the General Motors crashed, they had to sell the
division. A lot of other car makers, corporations went along with that once they saw the success of that GMAC.
Absolutely, they did. But Ford was also instrumental in, he was colorblind, literally. He hired anybody. Didn't matter if you were black, white, didn't make any difference. You wanted to work, he paid a very, very good wage, worked very hard building the cars, and as a result, of course, everybody that worked there could afford to buy it. This range was $635 to $850 for a new car, which back then was about 1 year's wage.
Mm-hmm.
And by the mid-20s, 1927, literally over half the country drove a Ford.
Well, wow. Let me ask you this. What is your favorite Ford to this day?
Oh, my gosh. Viper.
A Viper.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Ford?
I have
Ford.
A Ford.
Ford.
That was
Dodge.
That was a Dodge. Oh, excuse me. Probably the Mustang then.
Mustang.
And we're going to get to that.
Speaking of which,
I'd have to go Boss 302.
Yeah. The Mustang's still being made and is doing very well in its umpteenth generation.
Yeah.
Some guy, Lee Iacocca, which we're going to get to shortly,
yes.
Bailed out Chrysler and also developed the Mustang in 1964.
And I think it's really cool. I love cars. That the new GT500 is actually giving Ferrari, McLaren, and Mercedes a run for its money on the track.
Yeah, for half the price.
More than half the price when you see some of those Ferraris, which I think is
insane.
It's fun pissing off the big guys.
Absolutely. And then some guy named Shelby back in the day souped it up.
Yeah.
And then he said, well, if I can do it with a Ford, I can do it with a Gremlin. So he actually... I don't know if you guys know this, but he actually souped up an AMC Gremlin. And
well, that doesn't take much. I just put another battery in it. two more squirrels and a half a pound of nuts.
An extra hamster. Yes. So, moving on, we're gonna switch gears here. Pardon the pun. We're gonna go into fifth probably and talk about another innovator here in actually has impacted the world, and of course, Orange County here in Southern California is Walt Disney.
Wonderful interview.
And I just want to do five lessons from Walt Disney. I mean, we all know the story of it, and we'll elaborate, and you guys can chime in. But Walt Disney had very, very humble beginnings. He was not born to success, and he had to make and create his own success. And he actually went bankrupt once. He was a horrible money manager and lassoed his older brother Roy, into running the finances, and that's really what got Disney off the map and going, is because he decided to do his own thing as opposed to people buying his stuff. And
that's an interesting point, is bankruptcy, people look at that kind of askew, but so many great innovators, you know, have gone through financial problems and either lost companies or went bankrupt or had personal financial issue, but their perseverance,
yes,
and consistency is what, you know,
yes,
they had helped them overcome it. Yeah.
And Walt Disney was no exception.
Absolutely.
The first thing he do what you love. The cliche phrase is make your work your play and your play your work.
Yeah.
And
a question. Do you think that a lot of those people that obviously are very successful, and unfortunately some of them go through bankruptcy and whatnot, but don't you think the greats err on the side of aggression, and that's why they're so aggressive in terms of not on the downside, but sometimes you have to be aggressive in business and take that risk.
Well, they're aggressive and they do take risk, and that's sometimes that risk doesn't pan out, and you know, they end up with bankruptcy, but that they looked at that as, oh, that's a risk I'm going to take.
Yeah.
I'll survive. It's a numbers game. You know, I mean, Babe Ruth, everybody talks about being the greatest hitter in the world.
Yeah. Yes.
What they don't talk about is the flip side. He's also the strikeout king.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
But nobody remembers that.
No.
So he went bankrupt how many times to get to be the greatest hitter?
There you go.
And he also said if you increase your number of failures, you automatically are going to increase your chance for success.
Yeah.
because he was a strikeout. He had more strikeouts, but as a result of striking out, he also was at the bat more.
It's called be more times at bat.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And for goodness sakes, and this was way back in the day before steroids and everything else, right? He had a few more home runs than anybody else.
And I think he ran on gin. if memory serves me correctly.
And I don't know if you know this, but during the Depression, he didn't have any worries because he took all his money and he put it in annuities. Didn't lose a dime when the market crashed, and was still able to power down all that gin. And didn't have to worry about it. So the first thing we can learn from Disney as an entrepreneur is his love for drawing. He drew a lot, and he always was trying to perfect what he drew. And he drew for fun, and he drew a lot. It's funny. I don't know if you know this, but when Mickey came out, the name was going to be, I think it was Mortar. Yeah, and his wife said, no.
Yeah, Mortimer.
It wasn't going to work, so we got Mickey.
Yeah, thank God for the wife on that one.
that's true. Take what you do seriously. He always did what he did with focus. And it's just like a lion stalking his prey. He paid attention to every detail and dealt with things in the utmost care. He never took his art or his talent for granted.
Yeah.
Okay. Do it for others. And I think Disneyland itself is a testimony to that. He would always find ways in which he could share his work with others. And he said the value of the love for friends over family, hope for the good, and the most important lesson, good will always triumph over evil. So do it for others.
I like that.
Next is never just settle for your first success. He had a little movie he was trying to put together back in the day, and it was called Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. And he ran out of money.
I recall that.
Yeah. Yeah.
A little familiar.
He ran out of money, and people called it Walt's Folly. And he went around with little cuts of the movie in its infancy and was able to raise money. And got it done, and of course, the rest is history. In 1939, it did very, very well. And as a result of that, then he developed and was already springboarding into other stuff and came out of other movies. Maybe you've heard of them. Bambi, Fantasia, and Pinocchio, and many others.
Yeah.
And of course, as a result
certainly didn't rest on his laurels.
No, he did not. And of course, other than Mickey, then he had to have Minnie, and Donald, and Pluto, and you know, he just kept going. And last is do not let obstacles stop you. When Walt Disney first started, again, Snow White, it was Disney's Folly, as I said, he traveled around and did that. So Walt's dedication to full steam ahead is really what allowed him to define a generation of his iconic creations. So, and ultimately, Disney itself won more Academy Awards and more nominations than anybody else as well because of what he did and created. Now, Disneyland's interesting. We were talking about this before the show. It was in Anaheim, and originally Walt Disney had picked Garden Grove, which is a community just south of Anaheim, and Garden Grove didn't want anything to do with them, and for years, Disney didn't want anything to do with that Garden Grove. And his real good friend, Art Linkletter, for those who don't know, he had a show called The Kids Say the Darndest Things, and he was pretty well-known and was very wealthy and was walking around the orange groves of Orange County saying, you know, I'm going to have to do this amusement park and this, that, and the other, and Art just couldn't fathom. Just couldn't get the vision.
He's out in the middle of nowhere, 20 miles from anywhere.
Yeah, he was just 20 miles literally from nowhere, literally 20 minutes at least, if not an hour, with the Interstate 5, which is right next to Disneyland now, major interstate in Southern California. It wasn't built yet.
Nope.
And when Disneyland opened, I think you were the one that said that it was one of the biggest mistakes of his life that he regretted, and this walk to the car, every step cost him $1 million.
That's the rumor.
Yeah. And but how he started Disneyland, he borrowed from his life insurance.
Wow.
So, I did not know that.
So again, life insurance is a great investment, and you can actually borrow from it. And then 6 weeks after,
by the way, do you do life insurance?
Yes, I do.
I love it. No, I know you do.
I do different, great job, all different types of it.
Great job, by the way.
Thanks for asking. And 6 weeks after Disneyland opened, the 1 millionth visitor walked through the gates in the front of the park. Wow. Now, you have to understand that he cheated a little bit, and that is he had a little TV show on ABC every Sunday, and it was kind of like an infomercial promoting Disneyland, and everybody came.
The original infomercial.
The original infomercial, and it obviously paid off very well and has been wildly successful since.
And he spun off the Mickey Mouse Club, too. That's a lot of people don't remember that.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, he did.
He formed a lot of children's back then.
Yes. Yes, he did.
Taught right from wrong.
And yeah. So Walt Disney now is, of course, a ginormous media empire, just gobbled up Fox. So, and not less resting his laurels. Although when he went public, he realized that sort of the intimacy of the group was lost. And mm-hmm. for a while, he just couldn't quite figure it out and was lost. And what's interesting is he loved trains. And his secretary said, look, just get the heck out of Dodge. You know, you've kind of lost your way. Get the heck out of Dodge and go ride trains. And so he went all over the world riding trains and getting an idea for trains. And as a result of that, he visited amusement parks with his daughters. And from that, he came up with the idea of an amusement park that he wanted to develop on his own. So that's
awesome.
Kind of a little bit of the backstory on Walt Disney.
So what do you do? What do you do when you get off track, Sandro?
When I get off track, what do you mean?
When you get off track, I mean, you're focused. You're doing these different events. You're promoting Lost Republic.
Yeah.
I mean, do you find yourself having to reset once in a while?
Oh, of course. Yeah. I mean, it's one of those things like we were talking about earlier. It's a numbers game. Mm-hmm. And sometimes the numbers don't go in your favor in a week. And you got to – usually I always take Sunday. Sunday's my day to assess the week, hang out with my dog, have a beer, and just think about what happened. I was like, okay, well, did I do that wrong? Did I do this wrong? What did I do right? And then everything that I take away, I write down. And I say, okay, how am I going to implement this week? What am I going to do differently? Because it's always about – improvising and growing, and that's just something I do. That and in the shower is my thinking time.
that's a great strategy.
It's
a great success plan.
I just think that it, some people kind of work blindly, and that's awesome, it works for them. But for me, I like to take a step back and be like, okay, what am I doing right, what am I doing wrong? And it's yielded great for me.
Self-evaluation.
And a lot of people get inspiration in the shower, no pun intended, just because your mind is still going, but you're doing some other activity. It could be a walk. It could be going working out. It could be doing anything. And most people don't realize two steps forward and one step back is still progress.
It is.
I agree.
It is.
I agree. You can share that one with Lee Iacocca.
Lee Iacocca.
He went through with the Mustang, but anyway.
He did. Well, you know what? We'll do Lee Iacocca next. We got Walt Knott. Lee Iacocca actually started working for Ford Motor Company and was the president and was doing very, very well and was instrumental. And as we've talked about, in 1964, came out with this little idea called the Mustang. And as a result, Chevrolet came out with their competitor to the Mustang, which is the
Corvette.
Camaro.
Oh, the Camaro.
Camaro.
That's right. Yeah. I'm a Corvette guy.
It's another C word. Another C word. It's okay. So yeah, the Camaro was Chevy's answer to the Mustang. And
the muscle car race. Mm-hmm.
Pontiac Firebird.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And which we were all benefits of.
Yes, indeed.
And since you mentioned General American Motors, the Javelin. Let's not forget the Javelin.
Oh, my goodness.
And the AMX.
Yeah.
Well, there was the Gremlin, and the which didn't have any rear end to it. It was hilarious.
Yeah.
And then
they had
the
great names. Gremlin, Marlin, you know.
We didn't talk about the Pinto, which Iacocca was involved with.
Oh, no.
which again, Chevy came out with the Vega. In response to the Pinto.
Ah.
Chevy Vega.
I don't even go there.
Yeah. So, but he was president of Ford Motor Company. The company did $3 billion in sales that year, which did very well. But he had a big clash with some guy named Henry Ford II and was let go.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
So Lee was out of a job. So what did he do? He went across the street, across town, and went to Chrysler. And long story short, they came up with some tremendous challenges, convinced the U.S. government to loan them. And again, back in the day, this was back in the late 70s, to loan the government loaned Chrysler $1.2 billion.
Wow.
With a B,
which back then was a boatload. And everybody back then was going, what in the world are we doing loaning this company that was having problem all this money? Well, he actually paid them back 7 years earlier. Wow. Mm-hmm. And one of the reasons why is because he came up with another great car idea, the fuel-efficient Astro Minivan.
Minivan. Invented the minivan.
The minivan, which came out in 1986. So he struck lightning twice.
Yep.
And two entirely different car companies, two entirely different industries, two entirely different vehicles.
And he just recently passed, by
yes,
the way.
Yes, he did. He
lost a great businessman.
And what's interesting is I have two daughters, and when I got rid of my Mercedes and had to get my minivan, I literally said to myself as I was by myself, literally driving off the lot, well, here goes the sporty life.
Yes.
But you know what? It was a rite of passage. You had to do it. You know what I mean? I said pains and privileges of parenthood. You got kids, and you got to take them places, and got to have a minivan.
Got to have the minivan.
Yeah. Although I had to have a sunroof.
You're part of a rebel.
You're a rebel.
I had to have a moonroof in my minivan, so that's all right. And, of course, any responsible crawling AMC, which we talked about, and the Jeep is now, of course, part of Chrysler
that's
as well.
Right. That's right.
Later, he was a best-selling author. And what's interesting is people ask about his name, IACOCCA, which he came up with an acronym. I am Chairman of Chrysler Corporation of America.
Wow. That's creative.
Well played.
Later in life, he was really, and he came up with the idea in 2005 again to help Chrysler. And I know I remember this. I'm sorry. You probably do, John. I'm sorry. But in terms of Chrysler, if you can find a better car, buy it. And that sold a lot of Chryslers.
That's
when
the challenge.
You got the chairman of the company saying, hey, man, this is a killing company and a killing car maker. If you find a better one, buy it. So that helped the company as well.
We take that same approach.
Yeah. I like that. Nice. Same approach.
There it is.
You can buy a better ride, buy it.
Buy it. Go ahead. I'll come drink it with you. Yeah.
So that was Lee Iacocca, and he was quite a titan of industry from very, very humble beginnings.
Now, I live in a little city called Buena Park, and I know we have another Walt from Orange County that I think you're going to talk about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But real quick, I just want to finish. Lee Iacocca actually was Italian, and he was an Italian migrant and, you know, worked his way up as an engineer at Ford and then became, of course, very successful. So he definitely was a big believer in, if you build it, they will come. He did it twice. And last, we're going to talk about another titan in Orange County, which a lot of people know, is Walter Knott. K-N-O-T-T for, now it's called, of course, Knott's Berry Farm. And out around Halloween time, it's called Knott's Scary Farm. Mm-hmm. And by the 20s, it was called America's First Theme Park.
Yes, it was.
And it now has 40 different rides, and it has 160 acres, which is a good-sized plot of land. And it's a great place to go. Originally, it was free until 1968, and they charged 25 cents to get in. Mm-hmm. 1968. And he was actually the inventor of the pass. Disney wasn't. Disney still had little coupons you had to buy, the E-ticket ride. And for those of us that are old enough to know what an E-ticket ride is, and if you want to know how much those books are worth, go on eBay and they sell for a book of those tickets, they sell for like $70 and up.
Unreal.
Yeah. So
it's like a nostalgia item. People just love that.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah, they just don't make it anymore.
Yes.
Yeah, that's really cool.
Because that you actually, when you went to Disneyland, you got a little book and it had a certain number of A, B,
Kitty
C,
rides,
D, and E.
And then this Space Mountain was.
And the big rides were e-ticket rides.
E-ticket rides. Okay. Yeah,
they were segregated by ride. That's really cool.
They were set up by ride, by color, by size
so
of the ticket.
Yeah. If you wanted to go out and get scared and do the big roller coaster and you guys, an e-ticket ride.
Yeah, an e-ticket ride.
That's right.
The Matterhorn and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
And then back in the day, if you ran out of e-tickets, you had to buy more. So they had ladies selling tickets in little booths around.
Oh,
then they got rid of all that, and they came up with a pass. You just buy a pass.
Yeah.
And Walter Knott developed the pass.
Interesting.
So which Disney, of course, followed suit and others. So, and during the Depression, to keep things going, his wife was a phenomenal cook chicken. So they started selling chicken dinners.
Now you're speaking my language.
There you go.
Yeah.
It's fried chicken. Oh, yeah, with rhubarb pie. And oh, my gosh, it's delicious. And people still stand in line today for over an hour to do that.
I'm one of those guys.
Yep, absolutely. Yep. And now you can just go. You don't even have to enter the park. It's right there on the outside.
It's right there. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. And the thing is, to keep people occupied to stay and enjoy the chicken dinner, he had to come up with attractions. And so he imported a whole ghost town. for people to walk through and check out. And the first attraction was a stagecoach ride, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And that started the whole thing of Knott's Berry Farm and having attractions and the chicken dinner. People still stand in line for it.
Yep. Keep people busy while they're waiting for that chicken.
Yes. All three of us yep. have had it more than once.
But he's also known for...
Well, he got the berry. It was just a fruit stand. Mm-hmm. And he got this from this guy named Boysen. He actually perfected the Boysen berry.
Wow.
Yeah. And yep. so the Boysen berry is actually his claim to fame is. And so Boysen berry jam and preserves and all that is really a creation of Walter Knott.
Yeah. And all from a berry stand that started it. And then
yep.
you know, his wife started cooking to
make,
you know,
make ends meet. Make some
extra money for the family.
Mm-hmm.
And then they brought the ghost town in.
Yeah.
And in essence, they built it and people came.
Yeah. And what seemed like small steps back then are now big steps looking back. It's just, it's just continually building and building and building.
Well, he actually was, I think in some respects it was out of necessity, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, you know.
Originally, yes.
He needed to find a unique berry and came up with the Boysen. Then berries weren't going and things were kind of tough during the Depression in the early 30s. And so, you know, mom had to go do the chicken dinner. And then had to do attractions and then kind of just kind of naturally progressed into something more. And he realized when Disneyland opened, because they were Walt and Walt.
Yeah, Walt and Walt.
Walt and Walt. They were good friends because they both had attractions and whatnot after 1955 when Disneyland opened. And, of course, Walt Knott was invited to the opening of Disneyland but didn't go
mm-hmm.
and realized he had to do something to keep up with Disneyland because it was literally – it's only like 10 minutes down, 15 minutes down the street. So that's when he made the decision to start charging, having more attractions and roller coasters and whatnot, and to keep up with Walt. And they've done well. They hold their own.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, they're still one of the top attractions in the United States, if not the world.
Yeah.
Many tourists come for Disneyland. But they also have Knott's Berry Farm on the list, you know, along with, you know, some of the other attractions in Southern California.
Yeah, yeah.
And they still stand in line for the chicken dinner.
I know all these were way before your time, Sandro.
I know.
Well, you're a Northern California guy anyway, right?
I am. Well, I was born in Southern California, but I was raised down here a little bit. Then I moved up there to went to school and learned the whole whiskey.
In the Bay Area, Sonoma, Napa?
Yeah, Sonoma County.
Sonoma County. Wine country.
Wine country.
Horse country.
Wine country, yes, sir.
I was working with a group of guys in the early 90s, and it was 2009. And I was talking about one of the more original attractions at Disneyland was the General Electric Carousel of Progress.
Oh.
And geez. I know you
we're
remember.
Dating ourselves, yes.
Yes, definitely. And I started, and they all looked at me like I was might as well have been the man on the moon. And I'm going, oh, man. So I look online. When did the GE Carousel of Progress stop being in existence? 1972. And a majority of the people in the room were barely anything in 1972.
I was a thought.
Yeah, you were a thought. So I went, oh, my goodness. Now I'm totally feel old.
Yes. But I tell you, it's come a long way. And I live fortunate that where I live, I can see the fireworks from Disneyland.
Yes.
Okay, from my front yard, and the fireworks at Knott's Berry Farm from my backyard.
Best of both worlds.
During the 4th of July and New Year's Eve and, you know, every day in between, they have fireworks every day. But during those events, those holidays, it's spectacular.
Yeah.
And on that firework note, we're going to have to bid everybody adieu. This has been Networking for Success with John Dade. I'm your host, Walt Lusk, and we've had Sandro. So check out Lost Republic.
Where do you get Lost Republic?
You know, anywhere you shop. Just ask your local bottle shop or some of the big retailers, and they'll definitely find a way to
and
get
if
hold not, of it.
And if they don't have it, tell them to get it.
Yes,
tell them to get it.
Definitely tell them to get it.
And I'll show up.
And you can find the show Networking for Success on here at UBN Go or iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, and Spreaker, and soon to be iHeartRadio. So stay tuned. Until next time, we're going to wish you guys cheers, and we'll see you in the highways and byways.
Hasta la bye-bye.
Highways and byways and the amusement parks.
Good night.
Good night, guys.
Salute.